Good afternoon. Welcome back, everyone. My name is Bob Adler, and I'm going to be moderating the final panel this afternoon, which is Nuclear Power: Does It Have a Future in the United States? We decided to save our least controversial topic for last. And once again, we have an extremely well-qualified panel to address this issue. I will introduce them one at a time. And our first speaker is Christopher Thomas, who is the executive director of HEAL Utah, or Healthy Environment Alliance of Utah. Please help me welcome Chris Thomas.
Thank you so much, Professor Adler, and thank you to all of you who have stayed through a great series of presentations. I'm really happy to be here. Again, Christopher Thomas, Executive Director of HEAL Utah. And I'd like to know a little something about the audience as I talk to them. I'm just curious, by raise of hand, who's heard of HEAL Utah before? Okay, so many of you. That's great. That's wonderful to see you. Well, we're probably best known for our work to protect Utah from nuclear waste. But today, and there are many ongoing fights, and we're working hard right now to stop Energy Solutions from opening Utah's doors to something called blended nuclear waste, which is a very potent form of nuclear waste, and it can triple the amount of radioactivity coming to the state of Utah, so we are working on that. But what I'm going to talk to you about today is power, and nuclear power, in fact. So I want to talk about a couple of the issues that I see as really critical if you're going to evaluate the future of nuclear power in the U.S., but also in Utah, because for us this is not an abstract issue, this is a somewhat of a concrete one, because water rights were just granted to a proposed nuclear power project last month, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. So costs, I want to give some real-world examples of nuclear power projects that are at various stages of contemplation or development in the U.S., also some historical examples of nuclear power, and then talk about Utah. So I want to start with costs. Now, I could talk for nuclear power for hours, and I could give a whole presentation just on the public health ramifications of nuclear power. And I'm not going to do that. I'm really going to focus just today on costs. If you've got questions afterwards, I invite those, because I would love to talk about that too. But first of all, it's important to notice that nuclear power, reasonable Wall Street estimates put the cost of new nuclear power at between 12.5 cents and 18 cents per kilowatt hour. Now, to put that into some reference, Utah currently pays about 7.5 cents per kilowatt hour, and I believe the national average is about 10 cents per kilowatt hour. So we're talking about a fairly significant increase relative to what Utah's used to paying and what the nation is paying. And then at the bottom, you can see some comparisons with natural gas and with wind. Now, I want to give you just a little bit of a primer on nuclear power costs, because it's actually really interesting, I think. So I'm going to build up the cost of nuclear power. So first of all, think about the production costs, right? So this is like the cost relative to actually producing the next kilowatt hour of electricity. So you've got fuel costs. In the case of nuclear, that's uranium. And then you've also got operation and maintenance costs. So if you put those together, cost of production about 3 cents per kilowatt hour. Well, now let's add what for nuclear, and actually for renewables also, is the more substantial cost component. That's the construction costs. Nuclear power plants are incredibly materials intensive projects. That is about 8 cents a kilowatt hour. Now that is what's called an overnight cost. And interestingly, you derive that cost by asking yourself, what would it cost if I could just assemble all the materials and build this power plant in one night? What would it cost? About 8 cents a kilowatt hour. Now, of course, you can't do that, right? You can't really build it overnight. So what does that mean? Well, number one, you've got to factor in the cost of inflation. So that's, you know, your materials, your concrete, your steel, your copper. Those are typically going up in price. And if you've got a project that takes 10 years or more to build, that's a substantial cost component, just the cost of inflation. You also are typically having to borrow money. So there's a cost of debt. And then, of course, your investors want a return on their investment. So that's the cost of equity. And if you add all that together, we're showing this example about 15 cents per kilowatt hour for nuclear, which, from looking at Wall Street analysis, that's about in the middle of that range of 12 to 18 that I showed you earlier. Now, I want to give you another example, because when people talk about the cost of power, it gets confusing really, really fast. Because you've got different size projects, you've got different projects that are producing a different amount of time. So I want to take you quickly through three different examples. So let's look at a Duke Energy project. Construction cost $14 billion, capacity 2,200 megawatts, and a capacity factor of 90%. Interesting. That, if you kind of boil that down, that comes into a market price of about 12.3 cents per kilowatt hour. The Progress Energy nuclear power plant example ends up being a little bit more because the construction cost is more and the capacity is less, the capacity factor is about the same, so each kilowatt hour of electricity is a little bit more expensive, about 18 cents per kilowatt hour. Now I'm going to show you the Horse Butte Wind project. That's actually a project that was developed by UAMPS, which is a collection of Utah and then from other states, cities, towns. That build electricity generation. Now look at that one. The numbers are a lot smaller to begin with, right? $230 million is a lot less than $22 billion, right? And also the megawatts are a lot smaller too, 100 megawatts versus 2,000 megawatts. And then again, the capacity factor is a lot different too, right? 33% as opposed to 90%. That's because wind is variable, much like solar. But still, if you boil it all down, it's only about 6.5 cents per kilowatt hour. So I ask you, what's the better investment? Who thinks the nuclear is the better investment from just these three projects if you had to pick? Okay, one?
Because I want it all the time, not part of the time.
That's great, and I will get to that. And I like that you're not gonna ask me what I'm smoking. Clearly. And I will get to the reliability issue, but if you're just going on a cost per energy basis, the wind project is the best one right here. And then Wall Street also, I mean, the one I didn't point to on the last slide was natural gas, right? And everybody was talking about natural gas earlier, and Wall Street's basically said natural gas would have to substantially increase in price for nuclear to make any sense in the U.S. And I think that's really the prevailing attitude at this point. Let's look at historically nuclear, because nuclear power construction is one of the only examples that you can find where it's actually become more difficult to build and more expensive to build over time. Typically, with technological innovations, it becomes much cheaper the more you build it. So for plants started between 1966 and 1967, they projected one cost when they started building it. The actual cost was twice as much. Plants started between 1968 and 1969, four times as much? And it just continues to escalate over the years. So what the experience and the history shows us is that whatever you think that nuclear power is going to cost, it's probably going to cost a lot more when all is said and done. Now, you may say to me, well, Christopher, yeah, that's the history, but what if that's really been figured out? What if the new plants will not face this? And you know, that's a possibility. However, the experience that we do have, I think, points to more of the same. So let's talk about Progress Energy. And I just made a friend who's teaching here, who's from Florida, and we were talking about the nuclear power plants there. Anyway, so Progress Energy wants to build two reactors in Levi County. In 2006, they thought it was going to cost $4 to $6 billion. The next year, that cost estimate went up about double, $10 billion. In 2008, they decided, hey, we'll build two reactors instead of one, because we think that'll bring the overall cost per kilowatt hour produced down. And now it'll cost $17 billion for two reactors. A year later, they delayed the projected project start date by 2 years to 2018, further delays in 2010. And then in 2011, they said the cost estimate is actually $22 billion. And then just last month, the utility announced it was seeking to cancel its construction contract that it had entered into. Now, it wants to, I think, ultimately enter into another construction contract, but this is an incredible series of delays and costs even before real construction has begun. Now, I have down here at the bottom $1.1 billion spent. That's been just spent on paperwork, essentially. And guess who, so if you were a company, why would you want to spend $1.1 billion for a project that wouldn't start turning a profit or even any revenues till at least, what does it say, 2021? Why would you do that? Well, in fact, in Florida, they've worked out a deal where actually the utility's not really on the hook for that $1.1 billion. It's actually customers that are paying that. And in fact, so this is a piece of legislation called CWIP, Construction Work in Progress. It basically means that the customers start paying today, even though the power won't come online for a decade. And it also means that even if that nuclear project never comes online, the customers will never get that money back. So, I mean, think about this, that in fact, people, you know, investors would put money toward a project, they'd want a return on that. These customers will never get a return on that money. And in fact, I mean, it's only really a downside. Thankfully, in most states, the standards have been called used and useful. So we only start paying for those power plant costs when we start receiving electricity from those projects. And I would argue that we should protect that. In the state of Florida, Senator Faisano, who's a Republican, has basically said, has called for repeal of their CWIP laws because he said that they're unfair to the electricity customers, and he believes that the project, the nuclear power plants suggested by Progress Energy, will in fact never happen. And actually, if you look at the history, you know, there have been about twice as many reactor projects announced and had money spent on them than actually came into fruition, so only about 50%. So what about nuclear power in Utah? Well, I'm going to start by talking about MidAmerican Energy. MidAmerican Energy is the parent company of PacifiCorp, and PacifiCorp is the parent company of Rocky Mountain Power. And in fact, MidAmerican Energy looked into and invested a significant amount of money in exploring building a nuclear power plant in Idaho. And it was going to be a merchant plant. And eventually scrapped that whole project. And I want to share with you some testimony that was recently delivered in Wyoming, because there's a task force in Wyoming, a legislative task force, looking into this, and they had somebody from PacifiCorp come and give testimony to their committee about that experience. And here's one of the things she said. It was a massive project, in excess of $14 billion at the time. I have no doubt it would be more expensive if they estimated it today. And she said, look, the terms the constructors were putting on the table, in other words, the people that actually built the plant, you couldn't even call it terms. Essentially, they wanted a blank check. And this is what we hear time and again. People don't really know how much it's going to cost to build a new nuclear power plant. And the utilities don't want to be on the line for those uncontrollable, unknowable costs. And so again, I'm returning again to the earlier example of Florida, the construction work in progress. That's one of the reasons that the utilities don't want to take that risk. They want to pass that risk on to us. So we're actually paying for those costs. And actually back in 2007, there was a bill debated up at the state legislature, a CWIP bill, modeled on the legislation that had passed in Florida. And thankfully, that legislation was voted down. But at the time, it created quite a controversy because two of the people on the committee hearing that legislation, Representative Mike Noel and Representative Aaron Tilton, were engaged in a business deal that is relating to the proposed nuclear power plant near Green River, Utah. And yet, that had not been disclosed at the time. So you had a situation where there were two people who had a business dealing, which many would argue would be directly impacted by a change in state law favoring nuclear power, that had not been disclosed. Now, it has been disclosed, and I'll talk to you a little bit more about where that particular project is. It is now called the Blue Castle Project. Who has seen a TV ad or heard a radio ad about this project? Okay, so not that many, but I do know that they are out there. And let me go back for a moment. So for 3 years, let me back up even further. Nuclear power plants need lots of water to operate. And so the first thing that happened with this project was an application to transfer water rights about 50,000 acre feet and that's about as much as Washington County, all of Washington County in Utah, uses and consumes in terms of water for this proposed nuclear power project. We protested that transfer of water for that nuclear power project, and we weren't alone. We worked with a number of other groups and concerned citizens, and primarily local water rights holders who live in the town of Green River and who are primarily doing agriculture and are very concerned about what the nuclear power plant water withdrawals will mean for their business. Well, just in January, the state engineer for the state of Utah decided to go ahead and award those water rights, the 50,000 acre feet, to the proposed nuclear power plant, the Blue Castle Project near Green River, Utah. And then about, well, maybe a week later, a story broke. And here was the headline that ran in the Tribune. A cited financial backer of the nuclear power plant was a fraud. And the reason was that they were actually being, this company called Lead Dog Capital was being investigated by the SEC for fraud. And, you know, we think this is really important. So actually today, we just, thank you very much, today Heal Utah actually just announced with a coalition of other groups that we are actually going to call on the state engineer and ask him to reconsider his decision. Because actually, interestingly, part of Utah water law says that in order to get to be awarded these water rights, you have to show that you've got the financial wherewithal to actually put that water to use. And so we think if this purported $30 million potential investor in the project actually is a fraud, and we found out actually they only had about $10 million in assets at the same time that they were suggesting they could front $30 million, that's a real problem and is grounds for the state engineer to rightfully, lawfully say the water should not be approved for the nuclear power plant. There are also a number of concerns related to water, and I'll talk about those in a minute. There's another really big fundamental problem with this proposed nuclear power plant, even if it does actually get off the ground. And that, again, has to do with the cost. Because as you can see, the Utah average is about 7.5 cents. Well, and this Tilton 1 and Tilton 2 estimates, I mean, the Blue Castle estimates of what their nuclear power will cost, I think, have been consistently low. I've heard Aaron Tilton, former Representative Aaron Tilton in committee say, well, Representative, good question. What is the nuclear power going to cost? Well, about 2 cents a kilowatt hour. And we're all kind of shaking our heads going, how in the world can he say 2 cents a kilowatt hour to our elected officials? And in fact, what he's talking about is just the power to produce. Remember that second slide I showed you and I talked about the production costs, just the fuel and the operations and maintenance? That's what he means when he says 2 cents a kilowatt hour. That totally ignores the massive upfront capital costs involved in building a nuclear power plant. And we think a much more realistic cost estimate is actually this 14 or 15 cents per kilowatt hour. These are just Moody's projections, Moody's Investor Service. What does that mean for Utah? It means that if this project is built, it's not really going to sell its electricity to Utah. It's going to be sold to places like Southern California, Los Angeles, Las Vegas. These are markets, power markets, that are used to paying more for their electricity and that could actually afford this power. So basically, the way I look at it is Utah becomes a repository for high-level nuclear waste for the benefit of other surrounding states. This is not something that makes sense for the state of Utah. There's also water implications because nuclear power plants are incredibly water-intensive. I'm going to show you some comparisons on the next slide. But think about this. If, in fact, the power is going to be shipped out of state for contracts out of state, you can think of it kind of like a giant straw that's being put in our Utah water and being sucked out and shipped to other states. Because that's really what the net effect of this power production would be for Utah. So we'd be storing high-level nuclear waste in Utah and depleting our water for other states to have power. So here are some of the cost comparisons. This comes from a study out of Arizona, somebody named Pascalotti. And basically, nuclear power consumes 1.5 times more water than coal, 2 times more than landfill gas or biofuel, 4 times more than natural gas combined cycle. And wind and solar, so solar panels and wind turbines, require little to no water. So I was talking to somebody earlier about the nexus of water and energy. And in a state like Utah that has a rapidly growing population and could be facing increasingly drought situations, really emphasizing water-wise energy sources makes a lot of sense, and nuclear would be a step in the wrong direction. So let's talk about what are the options. So Heal Utah, we take this very seriously because state legislators were coming to us and saying, well, Heal, you know, environmental groups don't like coal. You guys don't like nuclear power. How are we supposed to turn the lights on? We had a speaker earlier today basically say, we're going to be, you know, if we don't have combustion, we're going to be sitting in the dark and in the cold. And we basically said, we don't, you know, we think that's a really serious consideration. We don't think we're going to be sitting in the dark and in the cold. But let us actually use some numbers and some analysis and answer your question. So we launched what we called, ended up calling the eUtah study. We believe this is the most advanced study of its kind anywhere. And in it, we basically asked the question, could Utah support its power needs by the middle of this century using only or primarily renewable energy? And I'm not going to go fully into the details because I don't have much time left. But here's how you answer the reliability question right here. So basically, in Utah, we know where our renewable energy potential is. We know where it's windy. We know where it's sunny. We know where we have geothermal resources. We know how to adopt better building codes so we're not using as much power. What we don't know, what we didn't know yet, was basically how do we integrate the wind and the sun, solar, and the geothermal when they're happening to reliably meet the state's electricity needs. And so this is just a snapshot. This is just 1 week of data where it gives you every hour. So the yellow is the solar energy that's being produced for every hour of the day. You can see it, you know, it kind of pops up in the middle and then goes away because that's nighttime. You don't have sun solar power during that night. The blue is the wind. And basically what we figured out through examining all this data is we said, how big of a storage component would you need? And could you integrate natural gas? And basically have all of these resources working together to meet our demand. And that's the black line. You want always to be meeting your demand. That's the definition of a reliable system. And in fact, when we looked at it, we built in another margin, just like the utility does, because you want to plan for having more than you actually need at any given hour. And what we found when we put all that together and we costed out the different options, you could affordably supply all of Utah's power needs from renewable sources of energy with an energy storage component. Now, we also looked at a coal with carbon sequestration or nuclear option. That one actually came in a little bit cheaper. Okay, but the cheapest one that we examined was about 75% renewable energy and 25% natural gas, and also with a storage component. And I'm happy to talk to you more about the storage component in questions during the question time if you do have questions. So I think that's a really exciting result for the state of Utah. It means that we could be making much better choices in terms of our future energy policy. Some would say that, hey, look, renewable energy, you know, benefits from subsidies, and that's the only reason that it exists right now. And I would say, look at the history. These are all of the federal subsidies from 1948 to 1998 on energy. You can see the vast majority of those subsidies went to nuclear power, and a much smaller amount went to renewables. And I think that's a travesty because renewables, remember, that encompasses a bunch of different technologies, solar, wind, et cetera, and any one of those, you know, maybe you could see massive improvements, or could have seen faster massive improvements with those subsidies. And, you know, I just scratch my head when I hear people say things like, gosh, you know, renewables, just they're not there yet. And I say, what are you talking about? People are building wind farms all over the place. It is completely commercially, economically viable right now. And if you look at, for instance, PacifiCorp, what they're planning to build gas and wind. That's really what they're relying on. So, you know, I think that the future for renewable energy is bright. There was a policy option that I didn't hear discussed earlier that I think is pretty exciting and I won't get into, but it's called community choice aggregation. And increasingly what this policy allows is for cities who favor and have, you know, really strong ethic in terms of environmental responsibility to basically choose their own energy mix. So if they think, you know, like here in Utah, about 85% of our power comes from fossil fuel sources. Well, maybe Salt Lake City should have the option to choose, hey, we want something that's cleaner. We want something that's only 50%. You know, 50% renewables and maybe 50% fossil fuels. Community choice aggregation would allow that kind of choice to happen. And I'm going to learn more about that actually this weekend. So, we're working hard to protect Utah from nuclear threats. We think nuclear power makes very little sense for the state of Utah for the reasons I've talked about. And we're very hopeful that renewable energy is an increasingly viable option to power our state's energy needs. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Chris. Our second speaker is John Ruple, who is a research associate at the University's Institute for Clean and Secure Energy and a fellow with the Wallace Stegner Center, and I should add a graduate of this law school. So please welcome John.
Thank you, Bob. And first, let me start by thanking Bob Kiter, Arnold Reitze, Jan, Kayla, everyone that's worked so hard to prepare for this conference. You've done a wonderful job, and really it is a pleasure to be here. I'm excited because I get to talk about water for power in a carbon-constrained world. And I think it's a very timely topic, especially here in Utah, since we are the second driest state in the nation. We have limited water resources. And we're in an area where supply variability is a significant concern. So what I'd like to do over the next 20 minutes or so is talk a bit about the demand for water, the demand for electricity, and the connection between the two, then talk a bit about our water supplies, and then turn a little more to the Blue Castle Holding Company's proposal for nuclear power down along the Green River. So to start with, when we talk about demand, I think we have to start by talking about population. The blue line here is the U.S. population, red line is the population for the state of Utah projected through 2030. Essentially what you see is the U.S. population is projected to grow by about 21%. The Utah population is projected to grow by about 35%. So we're anticipating 900,000 new Utah residents by the end of 2030. Residents that will require water and they will also require power. So, looking forward, I think we're not with the most current version here. Looking forward, the issues we have with respect to growing the population are not unique to Utah. Other Western states face similar issues, maybe not at the same rate of growth that we have here, but they're looking at growth as well. So the Western Governors Association and the Western Electrical Coordinating Council has looked at projections over the decade, and they have said that irrigation use, or water for irrigation, is projected to stay stable for the next 20 years or so. Municipal use is anticipated to increase. Industrial use is anticipated to increase. And in the four columns to the left, PC0 through PC3, those represent different scenarios for electric power production. And I think the important take-home point here is that under all scenarios, water consumption associated with power production is anticipated to increase. So it takes water to make almost most forms of electricity. And essentially what this slide shows, it's a little bit complicated, but along the top, you have various sources of electric energy power production. Nuclear power, coal, biopower, natural gas, solar, and wind. The left margin shows the amount of water that must be withdrawn in order to generate a megawatt hour of electricity. The right column and the blue bars here show the consumption, again, gallons per megawatt hour. And then the technologies are lumped based on cooling technology associated with those facilities. Because when we talk about electric power production, we're talking about primarily about thermoelectric power production, heating water to generate steam to then drive a turbine. That steam then needs to be captured, condensed, and cooled back down, and how we choose to do that has a very significant impact on our water use. So what you can see here is that recirculating technologies, kind of the middle range here, which are the ones we're going to be talking about later today with respect to Blue Castle Holdings' proposal, those tend to have lower water withdrawal requirements but higher water consumption requirements. and by comparison, nuclear power tends to be at the lower range of those resources. So, skipping ahead, looking at projected water, projected energy production over the next decade, the Western Governors Association has said again, most of that new production is likely to come from natural gas combined cycle facilities, with some new geothermal, some new coal-fired power plant, and some new concentrated solar. In terms of where the water demands are associated with those technologies, natural gas combined cycle facilities tend to have lower withdrawals and lower consumption, and withdrawals will largely match consumption over the coming decade because of cooling water technology choices. So the key points so far, the first is that our population is going to continue to grow. Demand for electricity will continue to grow. That the demand for water is therefore likely to continue to grow as well. And that our choice of technology will be critical, both in terms of how we produce electricity and how we go about cooling those facilities that we bring online. So where will the water come from? Here's a chart that I think, or a map that I think most of the folks in the room are familiar with. It's the Colorado River Basin. You have the Colorado River coming in here, flowing down into Lake Powell. You have the Green River coming in from the north through Flaming Gorge Reservoir and merging into the Colorado River. So back in 1922, the seven states that have lands that are tributary to the Colorado system, they came together and negotiated a compact discussing how they would allocate waters of that system. And it's a bit of an oversimplification, I'll come back to it. But essentially they said, we're gonna split the basin in half, we'll allocate 7.5 million acre feet to each sub-basin. They split the basin here at Lee Ferry. And I think what's interesting for our discussion today is back in 1922, we didn't know a whole lot about water resources, the volumes of water that were available in that system. The USGS had installed the first gauge at Lee's Ferry only a year earlier. The information from that first year of data shows annual flows of about 22.5 million acre feet per year at Lee's Ferry. Now, to be fair, we had gauges upstream and downstream at that point, and from those we were able to get some information about flows at that point in the river, but it looks very different from what we know today. So back in 1922, you know, which is about here, would be this roughly the fourth wettest year over the last century, we had we were in a fairly wet period. The five-year running average of flows at that time stood at 19 million acre feet per year. With the benefit of hindsight, looking back over the last century, we can see that the average is closer to about 15 million acre feet per year at Lee's Ferry. Looking further back, indirectly measuring flows, looking to tree ring data and other indicators of flows, we find that, again, 1922 was a fairly wet period, that there have been significant variability in flows over the last several centuries, and that there have been significant periods where flows were far below that 15 million acre foot average that we've seen over the last century. So, the good news is that, well, before I get to the good news, let me talk a little more about how we apportion that water. If we look at the Colorado River Compact, and I'll quote it here for a second, it says that there is hereby apportioned from the Colorado River system in perpetuity to the upper basin and to the lower basin, respectively, the exclusive beneficial consumptive use of 7.5 million acre feet of water per year. So the upper basin gets 7.5 million acre feet per year, the lower basin gets 7.5 million acre feet per year. We have a treaty with Mexico that guarantees delivery of 1.5 million acre feet per year. And then the compact also says that once these other obligations are met, the lower basin is entitled to an additional 1 million acre feet. So we get a total of about 17.5 million acre feet worth of obligations. As I just mentioned though, that becomes, okay, that before we get there, so let's start with this assumption that we have 7.5 million acre feet to work from in the upper basin. We allocate that first by setting aside 50,000 acre feet for the state of Arizona, and then the four remaining upper basin states, Colorado, New Mexico, Utah, and Wyoming, they each receive a percentage of the water that's available under the compact. So Utah receives 23% of the available flows, starting from a 7,500,000 acre foot per year assumption. We would be set to receive about 1,700,000 acre feet per year. But this is a little bit misleading, one, because we're unlikely to have that 17,500 acre foot number to start with, and second, because during times of shortage, the upper basin bears the risk. Going back to the Colorado River Compact, what it says is the upper states, pardon me, the states of the upper division will not cause the flow of the river at Lee Ferry to be depleted below an aggregate of 75 million acre feet for any period of 10 consecutive years. So essentially, it becomes incumbent upon the upper basin states to guarantee that delivery. If a shortage occurs, we bear the risk there. So looking at that, the good news, I think, is the state has been fairly progressive in recognizing that available water is much less than was likely anticipated in the compact. So for the state's planning purposes, they start with a number of 14,250,000 acre feet per year. What that means is about 600,000 acre feet for the upper basin and about 1,369,000 acre feet of available water under the compact for the state of Utah, which is pretty exciting, and that's good news because that's a whole lot of water. If you look at current use, we're currently consuming about 1 million acre feet per year from the Colorado River system. So there's a significant resource out there that has not yet been developed. That's about 369,000 acre feet per year. The challenge is that, again, the state has been, I think, fairly progressive on this front in recognizing that demand will continue to increase and planning with that in mind. So they've set aside water for new agricultural uses. They've set aside water for new municipal and industrial uses for the Lake Powell pipeline. And the state's also recognized that the Navajo Nation and the Ute Tribe of Indians are due certain water rights under the Winters Doctrine. So there are water rights that are due to those folks as well. Together, those sum to about 302,000 acre feet per year. So we're left with an available balance of about 67,000 acre feet per year from the basin. So, good news again, we're in the black. The challenge, though, is that there are a number of applications that have been filed over the years that have been approved but have yet to be perfected by diversion and application to beneficial use. And those total somewhere in the neighborhood of 400,000 acre feet per year. So we, again, glass half full, we are underdeveloped. The glass half empty, we are over allocated. So key points, again, and I think this is fairly obvious, the supply is highly variable and demand generally exceeds supply. So with that in mind, I want to turn to the Blue Castle Holdings proposed power plant. It's near the town of Green River, on the Green River, so a little redundancy there. I'm sure I will flip or stumble over that in a minute. The plant, as proposed, is about 3,000 megawatts. It's a two-unit facility. It would use about 50,000 acre feet of water per year consumptively for cooling processes. And what that equates to is an average diversion and consumption of about 70 cubic feet of water every second continuously throughout the year. So that gives you a sense of what Blue Castle's demand looks like, and I think it's helpful to think about supply. The Green River at the Green River gauge has an average annual flow of about 4.4 million acre feet. Back in the 60s, the Bureau of Reclamation constructed a dam on the Green River upstream at this point, Flaming Gorge Dam. And since then, they have been regulating flows from the dam. We have very good records of annual flows at the gauge. And what we can see is that since that dam came online, the lowest daily flow at that gauge was 682 acre feet. So remember, we're talking about 70 cubic feet per second of consumption the proposed power plant would consume just over 10% of the water in the river at that extreme low flow scenario. So that gives you a sense of what the demand looks like. And you know, apologies here, the slide is really, or the photo is deceptive. This is quite a ways upstream. It's floating down Desolation Canyon, but it was the closest photo I had. So that gives you a sense of the demand side. I think it's also important to talk about the legal supply, because water resources in the state of Utah, they're public resources. In order to develop that water, you need to have a permit from the Office of the State Engineer. And what Blue Castle has done, we should say that the proposed power plant is up here. It's the thumbtack on the Green River. What they have done is they've entered into long-term contracts with two water conservancy districts, the Kane County Water Conservancy District and the San Juan County Conservancy District. And together, these two contracts allow for the supply of about 53,500 acre feet per year of water. These are water rights that the districts filed for back in the 60s in anticipation of development of coal-fired power plants in the southern part of the state. Those power plants were never built. And now the districts are looking to convey those rights to Blue Castle. And the way that works is, under Utah law, a person holding an approved application for an appropriation of water can change the point of diversion, the place of use, and the manner of use as well. So they have to apply to the state engineer. The state engineer reviews that application and makes a determination. And in doing that, the state engineer essentially follows the same test that would apply with respect to issuance of a new water right. It's a five-part test, and the parts that are most relevant for our discussion are whether the proposed use will impair existing water rights or whether it would prove detrimental to the public welfare. So it's a somewhat challenging proposition for the state engineer, because his discretion is narrowly prescribed. Under the Water Code, the state engineer may not reject a permanent or temporary change application for the sole reason that the change would impair a vested water right. That sounds somewhat counterintuitive, but you have to remember that in the state of Utah, the legislature and government have put forth a policy in favor of development, both economic development and development of our water resources. For a long time, there was a significant fear that water in the West and water from the Colorado system, if not developed, would be used by other states that were quicker to put it to use. So in the event that a conflict arises, the state engineer has other tools available to him to address these conflicts. He can reduce the amount of water available through the change application. He can change priority dates. He can do a number of other things, but it's very difficult for him to deny an application. So what we fall back to is the law of prior appropriation, this notion that the first in time is the first in right. When a shortage does occur, those with junior water rights will be curtailed first, and the more senior users will be able to continue. And that becomes very important, because when we're talking about a change application, a change of approved application does not affect the priority of the original application. So water rights that were filed for in 1964 and 65, those priority dates generally remain. Now, I don't want to get into the details. One of those rights has since been changed to 2000 date, but you know, we'll come back to that issue of priority dates in a minute. So, as Chris mentioned, back on January 19th, the state engineer approved the two pending change applications. Requests for reconsideration can be filed within 20 days of that decision, which I believe would be today. Protestants have 30 days within which to file an action in court challenging that. That would be an action in state district court, and it's subject to de novo review. So we'll see how that plays out. I want to go back to this notion of priority. Between appropriators, the first in time is the first in right. We've talked a bit about the idea that with respect to a change application, the priority date reflects back on the original water right. And with respect to those initial applications, the priority date relates back to the date the application was filed, provided that the applicant is diligent in pursuing development of that water right. So the trick here is, remember, we have this portfolio of outstanding water rights that we're aware of, this notion that we have roughly 400,000 acre feet or so of water rights within the state of Utah, drawing from the Colorado River Basin, that have been approved but not perfected. The question is, will those be perfected? If so, how many of them would be perfected, and what would that do? What impact might that have on in-stream flows at the Green River Gauge? And again, I think it's also important to remember that we have those reserved rights that are due to the Ute Tribe of Indians. While those haven't been finalized, we estimate those to be somewhere in the neighborhood of 105,000 acre feet per year. Those would draw from the White River, the Duchesne River, and the Green River drainage, all tributary and upstream of the Green River Gauge. So, and really all of this comes back to a question of in-stream flows at the Green River Gauge. So I want to talk about one of the issues there in particular, and that's in endangered species and protected fish. There are four species of fish that are found in the Green River system below the Green River Gauge, or at some point in the system below the Green River Gauge. And the Endangered Species Act essentially prohibits any activity that would harm either those fish or their habitat. So potentially actions that would affect flows, that would affect rearing habitat, breeding habitat, and so forth. But what I think is less understood is there are three additional species of fish in the river that we need to be concerned about. These are the flannelmouth sucker, the bluehead sucker, and the round-tailed chub. These are species of fish that are not protected by the Endangered Species Act, but which have shown significant declines in their population and their habitat over time. Now, the state has taken a fairly proactive step in designating these as state-sensitive species and managing them to protect or to limit the trend towards listing. So we need to be thinking about impact to those species as well. So to try and get a handle on what Blue Castle Holdings project might mean in terms of impacts to these fish, and I did a little kind of back of the pizza box math. So I looked at the flow recommendations, the minimum flow recommendations that were made by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, the State Division of Water Resources, and a number of other entities a decade or so ago. And what those recommendations say is that during the driest of scenarios, we want to maintain minimum flows of between 1,300 and 2,600 cubic feet per second at the Green River Gauge. Now, because we have really good gauge data, we can go back and look at the flows that were measured at that gauge every day since the Flaming Gorge Dam went into operation. And what we see is that flows have fallen below that 1,300 CFS level 433 times since 1964. Now, if we take that curve and we say, all right, we are talking about introduction of 70 CFS of depletions on top of that existing range, we find out that that would result in, actually this slide's a little dated, it's actually 92 additional days where flows would fall below that level. Here I use 74 CFS. The difference between 70 and 74 is whether they would be consuming the full amount of water conveyed in their change application or simply the amount of water, the 70 CFS number that they're assuming in their permit application. So either way, there would be some additional impact. Whether that is significant in terms of those fish, I don't know, I can't speak to that, but it is measurable, it is something that we can look at and ask some important questions about. And these questions will be addressed moving forward because the Nuclear Regulatory Commission has not issued a permit for the facility. They will have to go through an EPA process. They will have to complete an environmental impact statement. They will have to go through Section 7 consultation with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and that will give us an opportunity to look at some of these questions about impacts to flows, impacts to fish, and address some of those issues. So we're far from the final chapter on this question. So in conclusion, some observations. First, competition for water resources is likely to increase over the coming decades. I don't think that's a revelation. I haven't talked about climate change, but obviously that adds to some of the issues that are raised by a growing population. The issue here, I would argue, is larger than water for nuclear power or water for power. It's a question of a finite resource in light of increasing demand. And since we're dealing with a resource that is essentially fully allocated, even if it hasn't been fully developed at this point, we're talking about choices. We're talking about reallocation and what uses we're willing to forego if new uses are to be brought online. So they're big and important philosophical choices for us as a state and us as a society. In a sense, these are not new problems. The doctrine of prior appropriation developed years ago because of competition over water resources, because demand exceeded supply. So we have tools in place that will help us deal with some of these issues. They may not be the socially optimal tools, they may not be the tools we desire, but the fallback is that we have a system in place that will curtail junior users if demand does in fact exceed supply. So with that, I will just stop.
Thank you, John. Our final speaker of the panel is Michael Stern, who is a principal at Stern and Stern in Maine. He is a wicked combination. He's both a licensed attorney and a licensed professional engineer. So he can kind of play two roles in those jokes about lawyers, engineers, and economists, the two good roles. And my final note is that John was a student of mine, but Michael was a student of Professor Reitze as an LLM student at George Washington University. Please help me welcome Michael.
Good afternoon. I'd like to start by thanking Professor Reitze, Professor Kiter for inviting me. We'll see whether I'll thank him afterwards. Without doubt, the issue of nuclear power is extremely controversial. What I intend to attempt to present either this afternoon are a few facts that might be a little different than what is presented in the press. They definitely are that. And they provide, I think, a little insight into things that one should consider and put in perspective, because there are no free lunches in this world. There isn't such a thing as electric energy without consequence. And it's important for society to evaluate those consequences in a reasonable way, looking at all risk and all costs. And I hope to give a little perspective on that. And also a little perspective of where the nuclear business is likely to go in the future. So the key issues are safety, environmental impacts, economic consequence and cost, and the legal process, which ties all that together. Any overview of considerations regarding nuclear power begins with safety. It is the number one big issue that you hear about, and just start through it and see where we go. Fukushima. There was an earthquake, there was a tsunami, there was a nuclear accident. More than 20,000 people died. Every time you hear an article, see an article in the press about the problems with cleanup of the nuclear accident, you'll always hear 20,000 people died. Not one individual died due to nuclear. Not a one. And it's highly unlikely that anyone will die due to radiation exposure due to a nuclear accident, because the Japanese are keeping the exposure to individuals, public individuals, and the private parties doing the cleanup at below regulatory standards. Those standards are structured such that one could not prove that any future cancer was due to the exposure. Just, that's the way they're set up. Nuclear business was controversial from the start, and they had competent lawyers. They set the standards the way to avoid that type of problem. But what happened at Fukushima, and what was it about? It was all units at Fukushima were boiling water reactors. All of the ones that had problem issues, Mark 1 or Mark 2 containments. The The Mark I containment is recognized by the NRC as having the lowest safety margin of all containment designs. Fact. That finding was not subsequent to the accident. It was a known fact before. Also a known fact, if you turn off all power to all sources of emergency systems in conventional nuclear plants that are running today, you have a serious problem. They were never designed to survive a loss of all power. What happened at Fukushima? The seismic event caused the shutdown of the plants. Everything was fine. No damage due to seismic. Then the flood happened, the tsunami. Well, that tsunami took out the diesel fuel supplies, flooded the diesels, flooded the electrical pumps, providing all cooling water to all emergency systems, and flooded all of the electrical switchgear for all electrics that are emergency related. You know, it just won't work after that happens. So then what happened? They overheated, their containment overheated, they had to vent it, the releases happened, the core was melted. It happened because that plant didn't have a proper alignment of its design criteria with the conditions that existed at the site. Basic siting criteria for that plant were not correct. That plant was designed for a 4.5 meter high tsunami, and they got the 4.5 meter tsunami because that tsunami height came from a tsunami starting off the coast of Chile. Not tsunamis off the coast of Japan, which they knew about beforehand, which exceeded, numerous ones exceeded 10 meters. And there was no reason whatsoever that those plants couldn't have been designed to withstand a 20 meter tsunami. It's not a problem. The structure of where all safety systems were located would easily withstand the wave. All they needed to do was made watertight. That's not what happened. All of the international evaluations of that event concluded it was a major mistake regarding siting, with one exception, the evaluation by the US NRC. It was silent as to siting. It could be that the plants came from the US and there was an issue of the permitting through the export license of the facility. But I don't go into that. I did go to Arnold Reitze's classes, and I did pick up a little bit of his sarcasm. It's inexcusable, technically. Inexcusable that sort of thing happened. Here, 3 Mile Island, it's another inexcusable event. Babcock and Wilcox design using a once-throw steam generator. It was the most advanced of all the designs in the current vintage of designs from a technical standpoint, superior technical design. All systems operated as designed. Now, what wasn't proper were the operating conditions. Operating conditions are the rules by which the operators operate the plant. They had rules that were in conflict. The operators had to make a decision of which rule to follow. They followed the one that the regulators were making a lot of noise about, and the noise was inappropriate. They picked the wrong one. They turned off the pumps that provided the cooling, and they cooked it dry. Radioactive releases subsequent were a result of the concern over the hydrogen bubble and an explosion in the reactor vessel. Fundamental element of the design of the reactor, pressurized water reactors, they operate with a hydrogen overpressure. The You don't get generation of oxygen in that environment. Couldn't happen. The people who set those standards or signed off on those standards forgot it and said, we're worried about this bubble. Ergo, what releases happen were due to an invalid technical concern. The vents were caused by errors by multiple parties. Everybody involved made mistakes, and they all contributed. No one was clean. Chernobyl's its own problem. There are no plants like Chernobyl in the Western world. It was a graphite-moderated reactor. Graphite-moderated reactors have one purpose. That's it. Produce plutonium, whether it's for weapons or whether it was for fuel for their submarines, which they did fuel with plutonium. I don't have an opinion, but that machine is only built for that purpose. It had no containment. It had positive feedback. That meant when the power began to increase, it wanted to go faster. In the US, you can't build a reactor with that characteristic. Fundamental error. Major control problem in every system that is sophisticated. It has to have negative feedback. It has to have negative feedback to be stable. The steam explosion destroyed the entire structure. And then it happened because people made a mistake. And what ended up happening is the mixture of the fuel with the graphite ended up with the reactor still capable to operate. Early data out of the Russian government indicated a continuing release of short half-life isotopes. It only happened if the reactor was continuing to operate. It appears that that accident terminated when it melted through the bottom of the vessel and the molten mass flowed out, was no longer in a concentrated area, and the reaction stopped. It took a few days. Why is there reason for optimism regarding safety? Detailed tests in the U.S. at Idaho demonstrated that loss of coolant accidents in light water reactors are really not as bad as anticipated. New designs are passive safe. They're designed to prevent the uncontrolled release of radioactive material should the worst happen. The operation of commercial nuclear power plants in the Western world have not resulted in any deaths. Zero. And had Three Mile Island and Fukushima had the attributes of the new designs, they wouldn't even have had fuel damage. Wouldn't have happened. Now, what happened here? Okay. Oh, okay. Any looking at safety needs to consider the risk from other sources. Here is the results of a study conducted by the Paul Scherer Institute in Switzerland, where they have looked at severe accidents, that means accidents with more than five deaths, in the various technologies over the time interval. Clearly, other industries that provide energy have a serious problem. This presentation is a result of all that data and that analysis of data where it compares the frequency of events with their consequences for each energy chain. What's interesting about this is the yellow line on the bottom is the results that one gets of a study of a very old boiling water reactor built in Switzerland. The NRC last week, Wednesday, issued a report of a study of two old commercial plants in the U.S., Surrey plant, pressurized water machine, and Peach Bottom, boiling water machine, where they looked at the consequences of a severe accident. Here I go, turning off all power. What happens? How bad is it? Their conclusion was the accidents won't be as bad. It'll take much longer. The releases will take a much longer period of time. And it's highly unlikely that anyone will die due to the consequences, either immediately or subsequently due to cancer effects or causing cancer. The other thing that the text indicates is that the U.S. plants, realistically, are near the bottom of this scale. That's the existing plants. And the valuation of the passive safes move it down another two decades. Why are we worrying about something that's 10,000 times safer than ever stuff? Now, I'm not saying that accidents don't cause a real problem. The environmental consequences are just what happened in Japan is, you know, just can't rationalize it. But it isn't the only thing that we have for technology that has resulted in severe consequence. Look at a blowout of an oil well in the Gulf of Mexico. Not insignificant. And the other comment I'll make about what went on in Japan is I look at people walking around doing the cleanup wearing paper air masks. I know enough about OSHA rules. Paper air masks don't count for much. And you don't see them using nuclear power plants to protect anyone. So I wonder what's really going on. Not that, you know, my point is it really isn't as dangerous as it appears, and it's a matter of politics of how clean they want to make it. Looking at the environmental consequences, without question, there is more water use. Members of the panel went through this. It does make nuclear plants do use a lot of water. The thing someone pointed out was CO2 capture will greatly increase water use in everything else. If you're going to capture CO2, your water uses are going to skyrocket in the alternatives. Nuclear is not going to be the biggest. There are no greenhouse gases due to nuclear. And there's a relatively, well, there's a very small volume of waste, and waste has to be handled very carefully. It is dangerous, but it can be handled. The cost of electric production needs to be gone through, because that was a major issue. Fuel cost, operating and maintenance costs, capital cost. Here are the current numbers for last year, average. In the electric power business, production costs of nuclear last year average is $2.14 US. Fuel costs are as you see. Now, what happens when you sequester CO2? How much will it cost to capture the CO2? Few things are more efficient than bringing coal in. Burning coal results in 3.5 times as much mass in CO2 as the coal coming in. Going out is a gas. You have to capture it. You have to cool it. If you think you can do that for less money than bring coal in, let's assume just it's the same amount of money. Cost of coal for sequestration in the coal sequestration of CO2 in coal plants, assume it's the same as for for the cost of coal, and we use the 50% number for gas. This is what happens to your production cost. The cost of capital was pointed out as being a very major thing. Well, how does it play out? SCNG, which is building a new nuclear power plant, just got rate approval at 11% rate of return and just sold $250 million to 10-year bonds at a 4.8%. What ends up happening in their 50% equity debt ratio is when you do a calculation of what their effective rate of return is, you end up at 11.28. What's important about this is that tax effect has a big multiplier on equity return. You have to pay taxes on it. That is a hidden tax to everybody who's buying electricity. And when you deregulate it, when people deregulated the industry, that tax contribution greatly disappeared. And it was a major reason for some of the shortfall in funds to states and to the federal government. Well, what happens in terms of value? What's the value of a year of production? Nuclear power plants have capacity factors in excess of 90%. How much is that worth? There are 7,889 kilowatt hours of generation per kilowatt installed in a year out of a nuclear power plant. For a 1 cent difference, that generates $78 per year. So how does that relate? That tells you that 1 cent difference on production costs, you can cover $700 per kilowatt installed additional capital cost. So in terms of numbers for what happens versus the alternatives, you end up finding with sequestration, the differential percent ends up being $2,300 per kilowatt versus coal with sequestration, and $2,730 for gas. That's with this cheap gas. Double the gas, because that's what we heard this morning. There's a real problem, because the current going rate for nuclear is $5,000 per installed kilowatt. You can cover the nuclear with the gas cost differential. So without CO2, nuclear capital costs are the same as gasified coal, 50% of 50% more than pulverized coal, and 2.5 times what it is for combined natural gas. Now, that's not the only problem. When you go after CO2 and start capturing it, you have a penalty because you lose capacity. No one's talked about that. You lose 25% capacity on average when you try to capture CO2. You also end up with additional capital cost. As to gas plants, the current gas plant's relatively simple, even combined cycle, because it's a gas turbine with a heat reclaim. CO2 capture isn't going to be cheap, and it isn't going to be simple. If you think you can do that for less than the cost for the rest of the plant, I wish you luck. It's going to be expensive. So the wild card in all of this is CO2 capture. It's a real problem. If you're going to capture CO2, everything's going to get very, very expensive, and nuclear is the clear winner. Trying to move on. The most important thing about the future of nuclear plants is the change in licensing. The old system was a two-step licensing process. Phase one was go for a construction permit. You had public participation to get a construction permit. You then started building, and then you went to the second phase, and you built the plant, and then you had to get your operating permit. You had public participation and open hearings at that time also. What's important is that during this phase here, you are susceptible to every change to regulation and the requirements. As the NRC changed the requirements, you had to change your design, and you're chasing the design. That's why all the cost overruns occurred. That and inflation. The new system is, you get public participation in site review. Over on the side, the standard designs, the builders, the designers, obtain an authorization under Part 52 for their design. Their design comes up. They get a rule. A rule is generated for the design specifying the details of its technical attributes. Once that is issued, anyone who wants to challenge that rule has to go through rulemaking, even the NRC staff. The legal process is over regarding that design. So you go and you pick a design, you do a site review, you go through and demonstrate that the thing, the combination is acceptable, there's public participation for the specific site, for the plant. You get your permit and then you start to build. You don't have the exposure to changes or anything else. Where is it going? The new thing are modular reactors, because one of the big attributes that the gas people have is they can build in 2 years. A nuclear power plant takes 5 years, maybe six. It's a very involved thing. They're very large. Modular reactors, they're passive safe, and what's going on is DOE sees this difference between the two-year problem with gas turbines and big reactors being a big disincentive. There's no reason you can't build smaller reactors. So there's funding to support the design of small reactors. What I'll do is point out a few of them. The key to all of these new designs is they build on existing experience. And we have extensive experience in building and designing light water reactors. We also have the capability of fabricating these things, these reactors, domestically. We still have that capability. We do not have a domestic capability of producing large reactor vessels in this country any longer. It all occurs overseas. The modular designs are passive safe. And here's a picture of one of them. It's a BMW design. And what's key about this is the entire reactor cooling system is within one vessel. The reactor's at the bottom, steam generator's at the top, pumps are integrated. There basically is no means for small break or any other accident. They're extremely safe. This can be transported by rail cars and over the road to the site. Put in a plant, and they can be the projected time to build this type of facility is 2 years. Westinghouse is doing the same thing. This is a pictorial of Westinghouse design in a containment. Containment's built on the site. The reactor assembly is built off-site, moved to the site. And this is the new scale modular design, which is even more interesting because it is a reactor cooling system in its own vessel, in another vessel, which is submerged in a water pool. This design happens to be something that was put together. An original concept was University of Oregon. Nuclear power has a bright future for the following reasons. It's safer than anything else. There are few environmental consequences. The economic risk is minimal. That's why in the states of Florida, South Carolina, and Georgia, public service commissions have decided to fund and approve new plants. That's where they're being built. All of those states are standard rate of return utilities, regulations of states. From the other speakers, you saw the Southeast. They didn't have much wind, and they didn't have the other problems with the rate of deregulation. And the risk of licensing delays has been minimized, and all of those issues are resolved prior to construction. And the new modular designs, and they're in the pipeline, will reduce construction times. The other point that I'll make about the modulars is that they're one of the reactor designers is included as an option air-cooled condensers so they could be put in an environment where you didn't have a good source of water. You wouldn't need river water. Your water requirements would be on the order of hundreds of gallons a minute versus tens of thousands of gallons a minute. And that's basically all I have. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We're going to take about 15 minutes for questions before I turn it back to Professor Keiter for some concluding remarks. So questions down here.
I remember reading that with nuclear power, once you get the reactor started, you can't stop it. There's no way to stop the reactor thing. It just goes on forever.
The reactor as a source of heat continues, but the nuclear reaction that generates immense amounts of heat that's used to produce power is terminated by shutting down the nuclear reaction. That is the first thing that is done when anything is off normal. That is referred to as a reactor trip or a reactor scram. And so the reactors are shut down immediately. What there is decay heat. Initially starts at 6% power and decays very, very rapidly. And that decay heat is the results of fission products which are radioactive and decaying away, giving up energy. So that is why you need to continue to cool the reactors after something is amiss or you lose power or anything like that. It's two separate processes.
Do you have a question? Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to know what will happen if Denver takes water out of the Green River. I'd like to know why the water engineer said that it was okay if they didn't have enough water flow, they could turn everything off. And I'd like to know how they're going to dispose of all the nuclear materials from things like the Vermont reactor, which leaks, and all the rest of them, which are all old and are reaching the end of their license periods. And I'm sorry, but that was three, but I figured I got the thing, so.
I guess I'll take the first shot at that. The first part of the question, the Million Pipeline, that's the proposal by Aaron Million to create a pipeline running from Flaming Gorge Reservoir through southern Wyoming and providing water down to the Front Range in Colorado. If that project proceeds and it is developed, it could potentially reduce the amount of water available in the Flaming Gorge Reservoir and potentially affect flows downstream in the Green River. How much that effect would be, I don't think we know yet. The state and the Bureau of Reclamation are in the process of looking at a number of these different development scenarios with respect to the Million Pipeline as well as all of these other existing and unperfected rights. So we're in the process of getting a better sense of what the future might hold and what these impacts would be. And those are the kinds of issues that I think I anticipate will be dealt with through the environmental impact statement that the Nuclear Regulatory Commission will do before it concludes its licensing process. With respect to the state engineer's decision regarding curtailment, if I remember correctly, what he said in the order was that on the Green River to this point in time, there has never been a call. There's never been a requirement to curtail a junior appropriator in order to meet all existing water rights on the river. So there's no historical incidents where that flow has fallen so low that we haven't been able to meet all existing water users. So that's part of the decision. But I think the state engineer recognizes moving forward that situation could change. In the event that some curtailment was required, it would happen in order of priority, so the junior most appropriator would be shut off first. There are presumably some appropriators that would be junior to the Blue Castle facility. those kinds of events, I think, would be, at least in the state engineer's opinion, would be predictable. We would be able to see those kinds of shortages coming. We would be able to take steps proactively. I think what is unspoken, but is a, at least an assumption on my part, is that if Blue Castle saw that scenario starting to line up, that there was a likely shortage of water that could conceivably cause curtailment of their water right. If I was counseling them, the first thing I would do is say, we're going to lease somebody else's water right immediately. We're going, it's much cheaper to lease somebody else's water right and keep that plant operating than it would be to start incrementally reducing operations. So hopefully that answers your question.
Do you want to take other comments?
Well, actually, I mean, if it's okay, Linda, I'd love to go back to the prior question because I actually wanted to say something about that. Is that all right?
My bad, sorry.
No, it's okay. I wanted to address it because I think what I heard in your question was something about the nature of a nuclear power plant and the fact that you've got to have continued power and water operations going on, and even in the event of a shutdown, in order to keep it safe so you don't have an uncontrolled criticality. And I think that's a really important point. And when, you know, I think The Onion, I don't know if any of you read The Onion, but I think The Onion said it best when they said, basically, nuclear power is safe, except when it isn't. And when anybody tells me that something's inherently safe in terms of nuclear, what I say is, okay, if you repeal the Price-Anderson Act, which basically limits the liability of a commercial nuclear operator in the event of a catastrophic accident, then those nuclear operators are able to purchase insurance, then I might start to believe that they were actually passively safe and that nothing could go wrong. So to me, that's kind of where the proof is in the pudding. And until then, I think we just need to realize that you can have something like Three Mile Island. It's good that nobody, I mean, it's great that nobody died, but as a, also another Mainer, I believe, former NRC Commissioner Peter Bradford said, well, you know, what Three Mile Island taught us is that a $12 billion asset could become a $12 billion cleanup, you know, in a matter of hours because of that uncontrolled criticality. And the same thing with Japan. I'm really glad nobody died as a consequence yet of the nuclear meltdowns, but we're talking about a $59 billion cleanup because of the contamination that resulted. So I guess those are my thoughts about nuclear safety and uncontrolled criticalities.
I sense a rebuttal. Come.
The issues regarding subsequent criticality of light water reactors designed in the West is not credible. There's no way that recriticality can occur because the design optimizes the reaction rate based on metal water reaction propensity for their metal to uranium ratio is optimized at its operating condition. Put more water in, it shuts it down. You take water away, it shuts it down. You put control rods in, it is infeasible for it to become critical again. Criticality will not occur just by design. There's no way for it to happen. If it melts, for example, there's too much uranium and no moderator to cause the reaction. You need both. So it is a misnomer. I just got a Kindles, and these type of devices are very useful. Mine was just sent down to me because today the NRC decided, the NRC Commission decided to issue the license for Vogtle 3 and 4, the first new big reactors that are passive safe in the U.S. They're approved. All that's left is for the staff to sign the paper up. It's coming back. It happened today.
Yes, sir.
Can you ask what the Vogtle units generate power for?
What?
The new Vogtle units, what will the power cost?
I don't recall specifically what their Public Service Commission approved. In the case of South Carolina, which is right next door, I'm more familiar with that case, I did look at the Vogel decision. What the comparison by the Public Service Commission was gas. And the uncertainty of gas with any carbon tax, with any sequestration, makes gas a loser. In the Southeast, their electric rates are the lowest regionally in the country, and the reliance on nuclear is quite high. They have a lot of experience with those, with reactors. Predominantly pressurized water machines, mainly by Westinghouse. And it so happens that in the pipeline, there are eight that I'm aware of, the two at Vogel, two at Summer. Summer's going to be approved in a couple days, just the same. Florida Power and Light's putting two more in Turkey Point, where they have two already. All of these are at Westinghouse AP1000s. And that's where it's headed, on the big plants. You asked a question also about...
What do you do with this stuff? Because all of those plants are 4 years old.
Okay. The waste, in terms of dismantlement, goes to a low-level waste disposal site. Regarding high-level waste from nuclear, it is currently stored on-site. The federal government has a duty to take it. Nothing is happening with high-level waste for one reason. That is composed of fuel. No rational society will walk away from something that has the energy potential multiples of what's been produced already by putting it in the ground. It is not economically feasible today because uranium costs a little. No one's going to pay 3 to 4 times as much to use plutonium as uranium, but you don't throw it away.
Chris, did you want to comment?
Yeah, I just have a couple of thoughts. One of the things about the Vogel approvals, I guess, which just happened today, you know, you and I are actually making a loan, a multi-billion dollar loan to make that project happen. And actually, I it's just another one of the subsidies for nuclear power, so people don't really talk a lot about that. But I actually find that the idea of that loan guarantee to be really awful. I don't want to subsidize, actually, a nuclear power plant. And I think that there are much better options that we have that don't entail some of the catastrophic risks that I believe are just part and parcel of nuclear power. And I do think it's interesting the concept that waste is actually fuel, because this is something that I think a lot of people back in the 50s thought was kind of the panacea. Okay, if we can basically reprocess the spent fuel and extract more energy out of it, wouldn't that be great? Well, as it turns out, only about 1% of the spent fuel can actually be reused as fuel. That's the plutonium content, that's 1%. And it is true that right now it's uneconomical, and my real thought about it is that we're gonna, at the time that uranium increases to the point where reprocessing becomes economical, we're gonna have far better, cheaper options in the form of wind and sun. So those are just a couple of thoughts.
Let's try one more quick question and try for quick answers.
This is probably for Chris. You were talking about storage underground or something that would sort of mitigate the wind and sun being only active, you know, by day and night, and there would be kind of a gap in energy for these fields. And you were talking about some magical storage method, and I was wondering if you could address that.
Absolutely. And actually, there are many different magical storage methods. The problem with a lot of them is that they're too expensive. However, there is a technology that probably most of you haven't heard of, but has been in operation commercially for a number of years, and it's called compressed air energy storage. And basically, I'm going to go through it really briefly, you basically use excess energy when you want to store it to drive a compressor that compresses air. You can either do it in a tank or underground in a big cavern. And then when you want energy back, you release it, you mix it with a fuel source, you heat it up, and you basically use it like a natural gas plant, essentially, where a lot of that fuel is being provided by the compressed air. Only it has a lot less emissions than a natural gas plant. And actually, one of these was created in Germany, the Hunsdorf plant in 1978, and the purpose of it was to support actually a nuclear power plant. because when the nuclear power plant needed to start up from what they called a black start, where the rest of the grid was black, they needed an energy source that was stored and ready to go and could start, and that was the compressed air energy storage. We also have one in Alabama called the McIntosh plant, and that one was created in connection with a coal power plant. In our study, we were suggesting, and we were using cost estimates for compressed air energy storage at a utility scale. And thankfully in Utah, we have some geology that would support compressed air energy storage, and there's a company that is actually actively looking at both natural gas storage and compressed air energy storage in Utah. So nobody has a crystal ball, nobody knows what the right storage technology will be, but that's the one that the utility industry is really looking at as the most promising for large-scale storage. Thank you.
There is one commercial way to store energy that's available today in the magnitude that is was presented on the slide, which was thousands of megawatt hours of storage capacity. That methodology is pumped storage of water, where you have an upper reservoir of water and a lower reservoir of water, and you use water as a hydro when you generate, and you use the hydro station as a motor to pump water when you have excess energy. That is the only technically viable mechanism for large amounts of storage. Nothing else exists as a practical matter.
Just to pick up on the comments about pump storage, you may recall there were proposals probably 2 or 3 years ago with regards to pump storage projects near Bear Lake. Those two projects have since been abandoned, but there's a new project, I believe it's in Sevier County. If somebody knows, please correct me, but there is a project coming through the permitting process right now in Utah.
So again, Professor Keiter has some very brief concluding remarks, but meanwhile, please help me thank the panel for being here.
I will be brief, and let me extend again my thanks to our speakers, to Arnold Reitze for organizing, to all of you for joining us today and sticking with us throughout the day. Very quickly, pink card, green card in your packets, valuation card, and to enable us to stay in touch. Fill them out if you will. If you're interested, deposit them in the box outside. A month, folder in the packet, the 17th, that just stunned me, 17th annual Wallace Stegner Center Symposium on the Legacy of Rachel Carson, in commemoration of the 50th anniversary of the publication of Silent Spring, will be convened at the University Guest House New Conference Center. Please join us. There's plenty of information about that in the packet. Finally, I can't let you go without a quick pitch. You also have a folder in the packet announcing the establishment of a green building fund connected with the law school's fundraising campaign for a new College of Law building, which, as you know from being here today and in the past, is desperately needed. And there's information about the green building fund then in the pamphlet. And again, thank you for joining us today. Have a good evening.